Well, good morning and welcome to Community Life Church on this beautiful Sunday morning. My name is Scott Verano and I'm the lead pastor here at Community Life. And it is an honor to welcome you today. You know, this is one of those tough days. If you've watched the news last night or over this last week, many of us, we wake up with heavy hearts today. Just not really sure, with just a bundle of emotions. And so just looking forward to spending time in church and time in the Word and with one another. And so with that, and we've been doing this ever since we started, we want to go ahead and start the service off by giving you 60 seconds to get situated, get your coffee, get ready for today, and maybe even to take that time to just prepare your heart for this service. And so 60 seconds on the clock, go ahead and go. Welcome back. And two quick announcements before we pray and jump into worship. The first is about Vacation Bible School. Many parents have been asking about Vacation Bible School, and Kristen has been working with her team trying to figure out what we were going to do. And it's just, there's no way that we're going to pull it off. And I think what we determined was there's no way to provide the level of excitement and anticipation and deliver maybe that same experience through technology than there would be to be able to have that in person. And we're not going to be able to do that by the end of June with renovations and also with social distancing. And so we just decided that we're just not going to do it this year. We're going to put those resources back and prepare. Kristen is saying something about possibly doing something towards the end of the summer, maybe as we if that allows. But just want to go ahead and put that word out there. And then also the Feeding Florida, we will have that tomorrow. And if you're in need of resource and need of food, you come here to the church, line up back on the Loop Road, 9 o'clock in the morning. And you'll be able to get you through the line and get you taken care of in the morning. Just so appreciative to have the opportunity as a church to be able to provide that here to our community. And so look forward to seeing you tomorrow morning. And so with that, I invite you, if you will, to join me as we pray the Lord's Prayer this morning. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for just this time and this space, Lord, to gather our hearts together. Lord, and it's been one of those weeks where emotions have been all over the map. Lord, and conversations that none of us like to have seem to be thrust right into our face each and every day with decisions to be made and opinions to be heard. And Lord, I just pray that in the midst of all of this, that you would remind us that we are a people that are transformed in light of a God that loves. A God that loves. Lord, in the series that we're going through on Jonah, you teach us how you love our enemies despite even the fact that we can't. And in all of this, Lord, how do we wrestle with what that looks like? And so, God, we start this morning with introspection, Lord, by looking at our own hearts and preparing ourselves for how we see one another, because we've got to change ourselves. We've got to do better. Lord, and so lead us as a people. Lead us to understand the hope that you offer us, and then help us to extend that to the rest of the world. Lord, help us to be better. God, lead us through this service, through this time. We love you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And I see heaven invading this place. I see angels praising your holy name. I sing praises. I give you honor, worthy Jesus. I see glory falling in this place. And I see hope restored, the healing of all diseases. I sing praises. I give you honor, worthy Jesus. We give you praise, all of the honor. You are our God, the one we live for. We give you praise, all of the glory, God.
Sing that again.
We give you praise, all of the honor. You are our God, the one we live for. We give you praise, all of the glory, God. I see glory falling in this place.
Hope restored.
I see hope restored, the healing. I sing praises. I give you honor, worthy Jesus. We give you praise, all of the honor. You are our God, the one we live for. We give you praise, all of the glory, God.
Sing that chorus again. We give you praise.
All of the honor, you are our God, the one we live for. We give you praise, all of the glory, God, all of the glory. All of the glory.
This morning, we do lift you up above it all. God, you are the one that brings hope into this broken world. You're the one that brings peace and comfort to our soul. And so we just invite you here this morning to be exactly that for every person listening, Lord, that they would trust you for their healing and those things in their life. God, for you to be their provider, Lord, the one that satisfies our soul. We love you and we thank you and we invite you here just to continue in this service as Jim Bell comes and delivers the word this morning. Lord, let our hearts be open and receptive for that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
There's no need to cover what I already see. You've got your reasons, but I hold your peace. You've been on lockdown, I hold the key. 'Cause I loved you before you knew it was love. I saw it all, still I chose the cross, and you were the one that I was thinking of when I rose from the grave. Now rid of the shackles, my victory's yours. I tore the veil for you to come close. There's no reason to stand at a distance anymore. You're not far.
Good morning to the two people sitting here in front of me, and to all of you that are logging. I'm sorry, Mike, I missed you in the back. To all those at home as well, or in your bed, or in your living room, out in your patio, wherever you happen to be, wish you a good morning and remind you that last week we were examining Some of the things that the Apostle Paul talked about, and some of the things he had to say about the leadership and the functions and the qualifications for people in the early first century church. You know, churches today, we talked about this last week, they have a variety of names for different positions of people who are church leaders, depending on where you go to church and what denomination that happens to be. You've heard people called elders and overseers and deacons, stewards, rectors, bishops. There's a whole lot of different categories of people. However, when you come to the New Testament, there is no confusion at all as to what the prescribed leadership of a church is supposed to be. And in this letter that we've been looking at, Paul's first letter to his buddy Timothy, Paul gives some very specific directions as to what the overseer elders are supposed to do and what kind of men they are supposed to be. They are to know and seek the mind of the Lord Jesus Christ, and they're to guide the ministry of the congregation as it grows and it develops and it spreads. Now, in the passage we're going to look at today from 1 Timothy, we're going to be looking how he gives us his attention now to the title of deacons in the church. And in the early church, the function of the deacons lay much more in the sphere of really what we could call practical service. So if you've got your Bibles, we're in 1 Timothy chapter 3, and I'm going to read verses 8 through 10. And Paul says this, and he's following up to his discussion about overseers and elders. He says, in the same way, deacons are to be worthy of respect, sincere, not indulging in much wine, and not pursuing dishonest gain. They must keep hold of the deep truths of the faith with a clear conscience. They must first be tested, and then, if there is nothing against them, let them serve as deacons. Now, when you read that and you look at what we just read in those verses, you're going to notice that many of the qualifications of this title of deacon are the same as what we saw last week in the overseer or elder. You perhaps noticed that in the passage last week on elders, Paul had absolutely nothing to say about women. Nothing at all. In the New Testament church, there were no women elders. Now, Jesus himself chose no women apostles. He chose no elders. But when it comes to deacons, it's different. It's clear that Paul includes women in this ministry. Now, Paul takes a lot of heat for the issue of women and the church. He just has done that for centuries upon centuries. He takes a lot of heat for it. But what we need to add and what we need to understand is, let's get a little perspective, if you will. Jewish women, prior to Paul coming on the scene, were never part of the mainstream of Judaism life. They were just not part of the mainstream of the life of Judaism. Women, young girls, were not educated. Women, young girls, did not attend schools. They did not attend synagogue with the men, and the men were the ones who ran the spiritual life and the social life of the community of the Jews. The eyewitness of a woman in court was discounted. It was deemed unreliable and undependable, even though she may have been an eyewitness to things. And the Greek culture, the Greek ideas and the Greek thinking were very, very prevalent in first century Israel. And those cultural practices sort of melded and permeated, if you will, into the day-to-day life of Jewish men and women. We have to remember that the 400 silent years in the Bible, there's the 400 years where God did not speak between the last prophet Malachi and the start of the New Testament. But there was a lot of things going on in the world. And one of them was the rise of the Greek nation. Alexander the Great, remember that. That all took place during this period of time. And so the Greek culture was all over the known world, and it permeated very, very deeply into the life of Israel. And in the Greek culture, women lived in seclusion. So you can see how this may have just passed itself on to Israel. Greek women never left the house unaccompanied. They did not eat meals with the men in their families. There was a Greek general and a statesman by the name of Pericles, and he held that women should live lives so sheltered that their names would never be mentioned among men for either praise or for blame. Respectable Greek girls were raised not being permitted to see anything or hear anything or even to ask any questions about anything. Some of these ideas and practices that I said had seeped into the Jewish culture in the days of Paul. And this is the world that Paul grew up in. This is what he knew. This was normal back then. So what we understand is Christianity, especially the Christianity that's preached by the Apostle Paul, was a great liberator of women. It freed them from so many things that were holding them back. And Paul's concern was that this newfound freedom would easily be misused, and it would not be understood at all by the outside world. The functioning of the church, as a result, would be adversely impacted by what was going on. And that's why these restrictions were put in place. You know, scholars pretty much agree that the function of this of the title of deacon in the early church arose from a quarrel that took place that you can read about in the sixth chapter of the book of Acts, and it had to do with the distribution of food. When you think about it now, bear in mind, historically, there were really two language divisions, if you will, in the early church in Jerusalem. There were those who spoke Hebrew, or they spoke Aramaic, and there were those who took up the Greek language, the Greek culture, the Greek ideas. And what happens is you really had these two factions that were in the first century church. So there's this murmuring, if you will, among the Greek-speaking Jews who had become Christians, and they were complaining because they said that their widows, the widows in that group or faction, were being neglected in the distribution of food that was taking place on a regular basis. Now, that was a problem. When this problem came before the apostles told them to go out and choose among themselves seven men who had certain qualifications who were to handle, to look into, and to ultimately solve this problem of food distribution. The apostles purposely stayed completely out of it because they felt that their role, where the money met the road here, was that they would get themselves involved continually in the ministry of the word, preaching, going out in prayer, seeking the mind of Christ. So what happened here was what arose was the first evidence of the work, if you will, of a deacon in a church. Now, let's look at the qualifications, if you will, for deacons that the apostles laid down in the verses we just read, verses 8 through 10. You're going to notice there's still no mention of any women. Not mentioned in those three verses at all. The deacons were to be men of good reputation. They were to be well known for their character within a congregation. Basically, it says, you know, you want a glass of wine here and there, that's okay, not a problem, but deacons were not to overdo it. They were to be sincere. They were to be trustworthy. They were to be honest. Some translations say that they should not be, quote, double-tongued, unquote. Now, it sort of reminds me of what Tano used to say to the Lone Ranger. Kemosabe, that man speaks with forked tongue. Now, I'm sure that's badly dated me when I let you know that I knew that. But I will tell you what, if you're listening right now and you heard it, how has that dated you as well? You're right with me. Deacons should be consistent. Not saying one thing to one person or one faction and something totally different to someone else. And that's really what double-tongued means. Deacons were to be filled with the Holy Spirit, meaning they needed to have a biblical view of life. And they were to possess the gift of wisdom, knowing how to apply the truth of God's word to specific situations, such as the distribution of food to widows. They were not to pursue dishonest gain. They were not to be wheelers and dealers. They were not to be looking out to make a fast buck. And when you think about it, we hear all too many stories today, way too many, of people within the church and in church administration where people have gotten caught up in embezzlement and taking money, taking things that were not theirs. So Paul is warning about what deacons are all about. As for the deacons in Acts chapter 6, they were chosen by the congregation. They were confirmed in their roles by overseers or elders. But essentially what deacons were, they were the church's helpers. They were doing for the many what would be difficult for individuals to take on for themselves. Now, let me go pre-pandemic when we were all here. We were all in this building. We were all fellowshipping and worshiping together. Because we have, and you think back then, we have tons upon tons of people in our church who really serve and continue to serve under this general description of deacons. And they are both males and females. Think about it. Before we had this pandemic, we had things like parking lot attendants, kept the traffic flowing outside, making sure the people got in and out. We had greeters, men and women, who welcomed people at the doors. They gave out bulletins. We had navigators, men and women, who answered questions and were able to direct people and to direct families to the various ministries that we have in this church and within this building. We had people helping people, acting as ushers, finding people seats, putting out chairs when we got too crowded here. We had security teams that were here for the safety and the help in emergencies that we needed them. We had people before a service and after service take down all the chairs that we had here. Tons upon tons upon tons of deacons working involved in the life of this church. It includes many other functions critical to carrying on an orderly worship service in a church. These people all serve voluntarily. And often they do it repeatedly, Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, and a lot of times without any thanks or any recognition for all they do. And we ought to be very, very grateful for all of these people. Pre-pandemic, at both the 9 and 10:30 services, we have attendants in our nursery. They're regularly taking care of the youngest of us, so that their moms and their dads might have time free to come in and worship and listen to the message and be transformed by the Word of God. Those people in that nursery are also ministering as deacons when they do that. And I want to tell you what, of all the things that deacons do, that is one hard task. There's a verse in Scripture that accurately describes the work that goes on in that nursery. It says, "We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed." And I want to tell you, there's a lot of changing that used to go on in that room. Those who take up the collection, those who count the money, are deacons of this church. When that collection is taken, it's not dumped into a sack and handed to some staff member. It's accounted for. It's deposited in a bank. So I think you're getting the idea here that we have tons of people in this church who take on the role of a deacon. And yet you hear us always talk about we need more. We need more. And that's true because we are a growing and a thriving congregation of Christians. You'll notice also that the qualification for deacons in these verses does not mention teaching. Does not mention teaching, although deacons very well might have a gift for doing so. In fact, among the first seven deacons that are mentioned in Acts chapter 6, Philip was an outstanding evangelist, and the martyr, Stephen, was a powerful prophet. They were good teachers of God's word, but a deacon is not required, based upon Scripture, to teach by virtue of the office that he holds. He may have that gift, but he's not required to use it. And beyond the fact that they must hold the word of God in a clear conscience, meaning that they must practice what they preach, deacons also need to be tried out first. It's almost like an audition, if you will. Verse 10 tells us they must first be tested, and then, if there is nothing against them, let them serve as deacons. And so obviously this implies something. This implies that there is some kind of initial assignment where they put people in there so it can be demonstrated that they can perform the duties upon which they're asked to perform. And if that takes place, once it's determined, it's inevitable that the reward of service is always going to be more service. That's just the way it works. You do things so well, and what happens? You are asked to do something else. It's not asked as a punishment. It's asked because it's a privilege to serve the church of Jesus Christ. You know, one of the things we emphasize here at Community Life, and we say this over and over and over, we say it in life groups, we say it when we have first steps, we say it continually, is that we urge people to serve in whatever capacity they feel led. Whatever floats your boat, get involved in it. But if those duties prove not to be the right fit for you, raise your hand. Let us know. And I'll tell you what, we will do all we can to find you a place of service that utilizes the gifts that God has given you. We move on in verse 11, and Paul now mentions the word women. Verse 11, he says this, "In the same way, the women are to be worthy of respect, not malicious talkers, but temperate and trustworthy in everything." Now, when you read that on the surface, you can be led to think that the word women, as it's used here, is simply a reference to the wives of male deacons. But that's not very likely the case for a couple of reasons. First, when you go back and you look at this chapter, you notice that there is no corresponding treatment of the wives of elders in the verses that preceded this. If Paul were concerned, when you think about it, if Paul were concerned about how the wives of deacons behaved, he would likely have also been concerned about how the wives of overseers behaved as well. But he never mentions them. And also, in the 16th chapter of Romans, Paul references and talks about a woman by the name of Phoebe. And he identifies her as a deacon of the church at Centreci, which was a port city just outside of the city of Corinth. And we are told that she was a great help to the Apostle Paul. So there were women deacons. And there are four characteristics listed here that women deacons need to hold on to, need to possess. First, he says they are to be worthy of respect and serious. And that's really the same word used to describe the men. Women deacons are to be realistic people. They're not to be out there following some will-o'-the-wisp. They're not out there to be following some rainbow, but they are to be women and people who deal realistic with what is presented by life in front of them. Secondly, they're not to engage, as he says, in malicious talk. They're not to be slanderers. Literally, the word translated here is she-devils. If you ever want to know where the word she-devil, it's right here. That's really how the word translated is here. She-devils. Women are not to be she-devils. And it refers to women who are given to the practice of gossiping and slandering the reputation of others. We're talking back that double tongue again. Now, obviously, men can do this as well, maybe even better. But in the context of the culture in the first century, women often gathered together daily at the wells. And that was a great opportunity for talk to start. It was a convenient place for you to say what was going on with your neighbors and your friends and the person across the street. Thirdly, women deacons are to be temperate. Temperate. Here again is a word about drinking habits, if you will, but it also includes other activities such as eating or working or any activity that is taken to an extreme, to taken to an excess. So really what Paul's saying here is balance is the key. Then finally, that last qualification is that they are to be, as Paul says, trustworthy in everything. They're to be responsible. They're to be faithful. If a woman deacon has been given an assignment, you knew for certain these women would carry it through to completion. It never would have occurred to you that they would not do that. And when you think about all of those qualifications, for the characteristics you looked at, we are so blessed in this church to have a great many such women as part of this congregation. And I could start naming a whole bunch of them because a whole bunch of them come to my mind immediately. And I'll tell you what, if I started to do that, that would get me into so much trouble because I would still miss a whole bunch. And I will tell you, there's a whole bunch of ministries going on here with women deacons going on that I don't even know they exist. Yet I know that they do. This church absolutely could not function as Christ intended without them. They serve in a ton of different capacities, and they labor willingly, joyfully, beautifully. And a great amount of that is behind the scenes where you don't even see it. I don't even see it. And they do things for which the whole congregation needs to be thankful. Paul then closes with a general word of instruction. And this instruction is both for men and the women deacons alike. And he says this in verse 12. He says, a deacon must be faithful to his wife and must manage his children and his household well. Obviously, this is addressed to, to male married deacons. If they're married, they are to be literally a one-woman man. We talked about that last week. That's not insisting that they be married because Paul was not married himself. And as far as we know, Timothy was not married. Deacons are men who, if they are married, what Paul's trying to say, eyes that they have are only for one woman, and that one woman is their wife. This is exactly the same requirement we saw last week in earlier verses regarding overseers or elders. Deacons are to also, however, manage their children and their household in a proper fashion. If they have families, you can tell a lot about deacons and their ability to function in the congregation by the way they run their households. It's a great way to see how that would measure up. All of this is to be taken note of when people are chosen to be deacons. You should be looking at all these different things. And then finally, Paul has this last word for us. And he has this in verse 13. He says, those who have served well gain an excellent standing and great assurance in their faith in Christ Jesus. Two things, in closing here, two things will result when the service of a deacon is done according to these guidelines and these qualifications. First thing that is going to result, it's going to create a great sense of appreciation on the part of the congregation with their service widely accepted, respected, and received. That's so important. Personal note, I'm a veteran of the war in Vietnam. And every so often when I happen to wear a hat or a shirt indicating that I had served, complete strangers will oftentimes smile at me or simply thank me for my service. And you think back, most of those people that I talk with or do that were not even born when that war started some 55 years ago. But I want to tell you something. Personally, to hear those kind words is both very humbling and very, very appreciated. Maybe we need to do more of that here at church, especially when we can all get back together again. Thanking those who serve every week for this congregation and for God's kingdom to thrive and to grow. Paul's words, if we do that, can then come alive. And he says, those who have served well gain an excellent standing. So that's one thing. The second thing Paul says in this verse is interesting. He says that deacons earn for themselves, and this is a quote, they earn for themselves great assurance in their faith in Christ Jesus. The word assurance, really, it can be translated as boldness. Boldness. When you serve the Lord, it doesn't matter in what ministry and what capacity He gives you, you find your strength, you find your faith strengthening, you find your faith increasing. That's why when we do VBS here, and I'm so sorry we're not going to do that this year, that's why when we do VBS here, you find over 200 adult VBS volunteers talking about how they have been served and their faith increased while they were doing the serving toward those children. It's the same phenomena we see when missionary teams go out and they return home more richly blessed and greatly strengthened than when they left. Great assurance, great boldness in their faith in Christ Jesus. They have this great assurance in their faith. You know, when you serve the Lord, doesn't matter what in what capacity, doesn't matter where, doesn't matter who you are, you gain. You are the richer by the gift of God. Would you pray with me? Lord, we thank you for the Apostle Paul. Lord, we thank you for the truth that he has revealed to us. And Lord, when we read these words, we see ourselves in these verses, in these passages. We see the things we do, the things that we get involved with, the things and areas in which we serve. And it's not a small thing to you. We have a habit of saying, well, I only do. And in God's sight, they are magnificent things. They are beautiful things. They are wonderful things. They honor him. He is so grateful when we come to Him in service, they are all important to the Lord Jesus Christ. So, Lord, as we go through our lives today where we can't join physically in this house of worship right now, we still serve in many different ways in our neighborhoods. Church does not stop because we are not here. Church continues, and we are the church, and we are out there. Oh, Lord, allow us to be deacons that make a change in our neighborhoods and in our communities. And we thank you for that opportunity. We thank you for the truth of your word. In Christ's precious name, we pray it. Amen. Hope you have a great day and a great week.